Good morning, everyone.
Hey.
Church family, friends, visitors, welcome to ReIGNITE Church's online worship experience. We are on the Sunday before Christmas, and we are bringing you some Christmas cheer with our ugly Christmas sweaters this morning as we praise and worship and receive God's word. We hope you're rocking your Christmas sweater too. Be sure to take a picture, post it on Instagram, Facebook, or Twitter, and hashtag ReIGNITE Christmas. We miss you and we look forward to seeing you. If you are our first time visitor with us, we want to extend a special welcome to you this morning. We are ReIGNITE Church, based out of Virginia Beach, Virginia, but coming to you live from wherever you're watching from this morning. We want you to know that we are a church on a mission, and our mission is to reignite love for God through an authentic worship experience, love for community through our regroups, and love for all through serving. If you would like to learn more about our church, please visit our website at www.reignitechurch.org or follow us on social media. Search ReIGNITE Church Virginia Beach on Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, and Instagram. Well, we are in week 3 of our He Is With Us series. And if this series has been a blessing to you like it has been to me, let me hear a shout of amen in this place this morning.
Amen.
And then place an amen comment down below. We have learned about how He is with us in the valley, and how He is with us in the wilderness. And we look forward to seeing what God has prepared through Marshall's message this morning. Now, a couple of quick announcements. Be sure to join us on Thursday, Christmas Eve, 6:30, for our virtual candlelight Christmas Eve service. Invite your family and friends and join us right here on Facebook Live as we ring in Christmas season together. And tell the kids to join us after service at 11:30 on YouTube Live and Facebook Live for our kids' Bible study. The lesson today is the promise of Christmas. They do not want to miss it. It's their time to worship. Now, if you guys would join me, we're going to prepare our hearts and our minds and fix our focus on God as we move into the praise and worship portion of our service, followed by the delivery of God's word. If the praise team will join me, we're going to go ahead and open up service with prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this morning, Lord God, and this opportunity to come to you, praise and worship, and to receive the teaching of your word, Lord. Yes. We pray that you be in the midst of this place, Lord God, and with all of our church family and friends as they're in their own personal sanctuaries this morning, Lord God. Allow for your presence to be felt. I pray that your people lift their voices high to bring you glory and honor through praise, Lord, and I pray that we can leave service a changed person, going out and showing and shining the light of Jesus to all that we know. Lord God, we love you, and we pray for a special touch this morning. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. Amen. Come on, team, let's get it.
Worthy you can.
Oh, For the worship that went up to you, Lord, for the talent and the ability for those who be able to call on the name of Jesus and usher in the Spirit of God. Father, we thank you for this opportunity to serve and to worship, Lord, and to wait on this word that you have for us. Father, we ask you to meet us. Meet us in this virtual space, in our virtual spaces, Lord, that we may know that you are there with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Hey, family, we are in week 3 of our series called He is With Us. And I want you to know this Christmas that He is with, God is with you. Matthew 1:23 says it this way. Look, the virgin will conceive a child, and she will give birth to a son, and he will call him Emmanuel, which means
God
is with us. Is God with you right there this morning?
Amen.
If you don't feel his presence after that worship, then you're believing the lies of the enemy right now. God is with you, and God is with us here today. And it's easy to sense. It's easy to sense that God is with us when everything is going right. It's easy to sense that God is with us when everything is good. It's easy to sense that God is with us when times of gathering with friends make us feel comfort and comfortable.
That's right.
Yeah. It's easy to sense that God is with us when everything is all well and good. But God is with us. This series is talking about how God is with us in other times as well.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
There's other times that God is with us. God is with us. We said in week 1 that this Christmas season, that God is with us in the valley.
Yep.
He's in the place where we lose our independence in order to find dependence in him.
Yeah.
He's with us in the wilderness, a place where we... Y'all got to see behind the scenes. I had to get that off me. He's with us also in the wilderness. In the wilderness, in a place where deliverance is necessary, but often delayed.
Yeah.
Yeah, so God is with us. I also want you to know today that God is with us in the storms.
Yes, that's right.
Yeah, God is with us in the storms. Somebody type in the storm in the chat. He's with us in the storm. Let's get into his word. Oh, man. When I was growing up, I often heard that you're either in a storm, you're either coming out of a storm, you're either in a storm or a storm is coming.
That's right.
Let me say it this way. You're either you're coming out of a difficult situation, in a difficult situation, or a difficult situation is coming. Can I get a witness?
Yes.
Yeah, y'all realize that too. It's easy to see that, to wonder, where is God in all that? Where is he in the storms, in the difficult situations? Where is God? Where is God? Being from Oklahoma, I know a little something about storms. Mm-hmm. You know, Oklahoma is known as Tornado Valley. Let me get over here a little bit. Oklahoma is known as Tornado Alley. And there, we see that storms are classified from 1 through 5. 1 through 5. Category 1 through 5, storms are either category 1, not as bad.
Yep.
Category 2, worse. All the way up to category 5, the worst when it comes to tornadoes.
Yep.
And when it comes to hurricanes, hurricanes are different kinds of storms. Hurricanes are horrible, but they're different kinds of storms. And hurricanes don't have a category necessarily by number. Hurricanes are categorized by name. Mm-hmm. We get Hurricane Irma, Hurricane Katrina, mm-hmm. Hurricane Harvey. Mm-hmm. Why is that? Why are horrible hurricanes, why are these kind of storms named? It's because these conditions are normal and common. And so in order to avoid confusion, meteorologists give them names.
Yeah.
In fact, back in 1953, meteorologists started naming hurricanes by the names of their girlfriends and their wives. Yeah.
Tearing up some stuff.
Yeah, tearing up some stuff. I can't even imagine saying Tornado Tiffany. I can't even imagine, Marco, you saying Hurricane... Hurricane Heather. But back in 1978, storms received equal opportunity rights, and men's names were included as storms as well, such as Hurricane Harvey, as I already said. And that's crazy. That's crazy. Well, what if we had named our situations that we experience every day? What if we named those things? When you're mad at me because I'm not in your virtual space, when you're mad at Pastor, I become Messy Marshall. Yeah. What if in the past you were late for work because you tied one over and you named that situation Hangover Harry or Hangover Hillary, Hangover Helen? Okay, it's getting personal. What if who would admit that they were ever in a situation that they were late because Diarrhea Diana hit?
Oh.
And it was bad. And it was really, really bad. What if we named everyday situations Dirty Diana? No, let me stop. No, Michael Jackson's coming over me. It's crazy. But where am I going with this? The reason why I say that is because someone has a storm with a name on it today.
That's right, yes.
This Christmas, I want to help somebody who's named their everyday situation because they felt like, I could not get through this storm of betrayal. So betrayal was the name. I'm having a hard time dealing with this storm of divorce or this storm of depression, and so they give it a name. So, or this financial storm, Pastor, I'm waiting. Pastor, when is this financial storm going to be over? Unfortunately, we know that some storms last longer than others.
Yeah.
Some storms linger a little bit longer than others. And sometimes when we're in a storm, Tiff, we feel like God is MIA. Mm-hmm. Can you get with us?
Yeah.
All right. So write this down. If you're taking notes, never let the presence of a storm cause you to doubt the presence of God.
Yes.
Yeah. Never let the presence of a storm cause you to doubt the presence of God. So in today's teaching from Acts 27, I'm going to use a few verses, and then I want to summarize the whole chapter. And we're in Acts 27, we're going to pretty much stay right there today. I'm just going to share a few verses. In today's teaching, Paul is a prisoner. He's a prisoner on his way to Rome. And the only thing that he's been charged for is loving God too much. Loving God and talking for God. And so these sailors and soldiers are escorting him to Rome, and he's got to stand before Caesar for this trial for loving God and proclaiming God. But a storm comes up on the way.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
A storm comes up. It's a nor'easter. A storm comes up on the way, and it starts tearing the ship apart. And these guys started throwing cargo overboard in order to help the situation. They were throwing things over the side to keep the ship afloat. And I wonder, have you ever had a situation that you tried to help along without God?
Yeah.
Oh, man. Oh, man. You've had situations like excuses that you tried to help.
Wow.
Like getting rid of them. You've had fear that you've tried to help out the situation with. You've had a fixed mindset that you tried to help God along with without his help. These guys are in a situation where our Bible tells us that they're in a storm and they're trying to fix it without God. And so Paul helps us out here in Acts 27, verse 20. Do you have your Bibles, church family? Do you have your Bible handy? Acts 27, verse 20 says, "The terrible storm raged for many days, blotting out the sun and the stars until at last all hope was gone." In a storm, the enemy of our soul wants us to know that we can lose all hope within that situation.
Yep.
That's what the enemy of our soul wants us to know. Mm-hmm. But not all hope is gone.
Not all
hope is never gone. And somebody is dealing with something right now this holiday season. Maybe it's because of the pandemic. Maybe it's because of your finances. Maybe because you're feeling alone and lonely. Whatever the situation, but you're feeling like all hope is gone. It's Christmas and everybody should be merry, but I don't feel merry, Pastor. And that's why I'm doing this series. I want you to understand that God is with you right where you are. In the storm. In the storm. All hope is never gone. That's because storms are never indefinite. You know, being from Oklahoma, one of the other benefits of being in a storm and being from Oklahoma, seeing storms all the time, is sometimes on the flat plains of Oklahoma, you can see a storm's beginning and end. Storms are not indefinite. They come and go. But sometimes they seem to last a little longer. Some storms do. If you're a believer, you're in the hope business.
Mm-hmm.
If you're a believer, you're in the hope business. That's what we do. We give hope.
That's right.
We give hope.
That's right.
And when I see people that lose hope, when I see people that lose hope and they feel like all hope is gone, it breaks my heart a little bit.
Yeah.
When I find people that feel like this will never happen for me, whatever it is, this will never happen for me. And I want to tell them, I want to put my arms around them and tell them, if it happened for one person, it can happen for you.
Yes.
But sometimes people feel like it'll always be this way.
Mm-hmm.
It'll always be this way. But trouble don't last always.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We'll never climb out of this debt. But sometimes you have to see yourself out before you find your way out.
That's right.
Let's say that again. You have to see your way out before you find your way out. The statements like these often are said because we don't realize, when we don't remember, that storms are not indefinite.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
There's an end to it. Somebody say, there's an end to it in the chat.
Mm-hmm.
But let's move on. All hope was gone. Then, making matters worse, verse 21 says, no one had eaten for a long time. Now, family, I can get through a lot if I'm full. I can get through a lot as long as I can eat.
Yeah.
If we can eat, I'm good, Tiff. If we have no furniture in the house but the pantry's full,
good.
I'm good. As long as my belly is content, I can get through a lot. But when I'm hungry, when I'm hangry, then the real marshal usually tries to show up. But Paul says, no one had eaten for a long time. This had been about 2 weeks that they were in this storm. Day and night, it was still raging. It was still raging. It was still cold. It was still windy. The boat was still rocking. Things were so crazy for them. And these were expert sailors. And then you had some soldiers there. But they hadn't eaten because they were so worried. Verse 21 goes on to say, finally, Paul called the crew together and said, men, You should have listened to me in the first place and not left Crete. You should have avoided all, you would have avoided all this damage and loss if they had listened to Paul. And I'm wondering, Paul, how are you going to say that right here? Because Paul, you would get throat punched. Mm-hmm. I'm like, Paul, are you really? Are you really giving the I told you so speech right here? We hungry? We hangry? The storm's raging? And you're saying, man, you should have listened to me. Anthony, you should have listened to me.
I know.
And we wouldn't be in this situation. Somebody put in the chat, Paul, it's too soon. It's too soon. It's too soon. But Paul was right. But Paul was right. They're in this situation because when they got to Crete on their way to Rome, they should have stopped there because the conditions weren't favorable. I wonder, have you manufactured your own unfavorable conditions in your life?
Yep.
Man. Mm. Paul is saying, we're in this situation because it was y'all's fault. They wanted to keep going. Yeah, instead of stopping for a little bit. Remember this, if you're taking notes. It's easy to believe that God will get you out if God allowed you to get in. Man, but how much harder is it for us to believe that God can get us out if we get ourselves in?
That's right.
Whatever it is, whatever in is, you know, if I get myself in it, you know, when I drink too much, you know, when I'm out too late, up too late, when I start, you know, eating too much, it's harder to believe that God can help me when I can't help myself.
Yeah.
Paul's argument is that sometimes we manufacture our own misfortune, our own unfavorable conditions when storms come into our lives. You manufacture your own storm, family, when you let your emotions get the best of you.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You might manufacture your own storm when you procrastinate too long. Mm-hmm. You might manufacture your own storm when you spend money that you don't have. How many of you are waiting on a stimulus check right now? And y'all done spent it for Christmas. Sometimes we manufacture our own storms in our own lives. Sometimes the storm is your fault. Sometimes the storm is your fault. You decided to date somebody who wasn't designated to be your mate. And your mama told you not to date him. Your daddy told you not to date him. Your best friend told you not to date him. Your pastor told you not to date him. Your fortune cookie told you not to date him. But you picked potential, and you picked wrong. Sometimes the storms in our lives are our own fault. And we manufacture our own unfavorable conditions in our lives. Maybe the sailors lost all hope because of their own bad decisions to sail on.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. But of course, every storm, Ed, is not our fault. Mm. Just look at Pastor. Don't look around. Don't look around your room. Just look right here. Every storm is not your fault. Sometimes the storms in our lives are the fault of others.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Put true in the chat if you agree with me. Put true in the chat. When I was young, my parents divorced at the age of 11. My parents divorced, and my two sisters and I were casualties of their crisis.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. But it taught me something about relationships. It taught me that we cannot avoid some storms, but we can learn from them.
Yes, that's true.
Yeah, yeah. If we can see the presence of God in the situation, in my case, it was in the divorce, and then later God would use that for me to talk and help couples heal in their marriages. If we can see the presence of God in something, if we can learn something while we're in the storm, it's helpful for us because God can use our storm to help other people.
Yes.
As they navigate life. In verse 22, Paul says something strange here. He says, take courage. None of you will lose your lives, even though the ship will go down. Mm-hmm. Man, what? I want it both ways, Marco. I want my cake and eat it too. Yeah. You're like, okay, you're going to be okay, but we're going to take a leg. What? That's what Paul is saying. It sounds oxymoronic. Paul is saying here, for last night, an angel of God, to whom I belong and whom I serve, stood beside me. So he had this image. And he said, don't be afraid, Paul, for you will surely stand trial before Caesar. So he's going to make it to his destination. You know, sometimes we go through things. We're going to make it to the end, but we're going to endure some things. What's more, the angel said, God in his goodness has granted safety to everyone sailing with you. Yeah. This might not be much of a Christmas message for you until you realize that everybody in your household is going to make it.
Right.
You're going to make it. Your daughter is going to make it. Your neighbors are going to make it. Paul is saying you're going to make it to God's prophetic end. Yeah. 2020 has looked dark for most of us. 2020 has been a challenge for most of us. 2020 has looked like, you know, who's navigating this course, you know? But we're going to make it. We're going to make it. We're going to make it because we're connected. Mm-hmm. Y'all hear what I said?
That's right.
We're going to make it because we're connected.
Amen.
In other words, because somebody on the ship knows God.
Yeah. That's right.
Somebody in the house knows God.
That's right.
Somebody in the neighborhood. If God's blessing your neighbor, that means he's in the neighborhood. Right. Because God is present in somebody's life that's connected to you, you're going to make it.
Yes.
Amen. You're going to make it. Yeah. God is still using angels to serve and protect. I believe that. Mm-hmm. He uses angels. We just can't see them. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Somebody may be struggling with that point right there. How can God use an angel to deliver a message today? But Hebrews 13, 1 and 2 says that we are to show love and hospitality to others.
Yeah.
Because in this lifetime, we entertain angels unaware.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. So we got to be kind to strangers. Because yeah. That's what the text says.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Because you never know who you may be talking to, who God may have sent into your life.
That's right.
Yeah. So Paul had an angelic encounter in a storm. And it represented the presence of God because he had a message from God. And when we're loving and hospitable to others, we present the Spirit of Jesus as well.
Yeah.
We see the Spirit of Jesus when we run into another believer. And Jesus says this about hospitality, even though he didn't go to our church, he didn't go to ReIgnite. Mm. But he said this, when I was hungry this Christmas, when I was hungry this Christmas, y'all fed me.
That's right. Amen.
When I was thirsty this Christmas, you gave me drink.
That's right.
I didn't go to your church.
Yeah.
But y'all did it. When I had a wish list, just because I needed hope, you guys provided hope.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Hospitality and love in the middle of a storm.
Yep.
Man, call me cocky, call me confident, but I still believe that the presence of God is available in our storms.
That's right.
Because God is omnipotent. God is omnipresent. He's present everywhere. Yes. The psalmist says this in Psalm 139, I can never escape your spirit. I can never get away from your presence. If I go up to heaven, you are there. Mm-hmm. If I go down to the grave, you are there. The presence of God is everywhere. Yes. Everywhere. I find comfort in that in Oklahoma, where my mom lives, the presence of God is there. In Chicago, the presence of God. Missouri, Texas, The presence of God is there. The presence of God is all across North America in believers. The presence of God is abroad in believers in the world. There's comfort and hope in knowing that God's presence can be everywhere, omni, everywhere present. When my daughter Lexi was younger, she had a problem with sleeping in her room. So she had a fear of sleeping. So we would ask her to leave the TV on, leave the lights on, but nothing helped. And so we were in this storm together as a family. Because she couldn't sleep and she was up, we all were up. And so one day it dawned on me to bless her room. So I went in there with oil, made the cross image, said my prayer, and I explained to Lexi that the Spirit of God, the presence of God, was here with her in her room as he is with us in the rest of the house. And until then, she couldn't sleep, but understanding that the Spirit of God, the presence of God was with her, she's been sleeping in her room without fear ever since.
Amen.
Yeah. Because everything changes when you know who's with you.
Yeah. Amen.
Did you hear what I just said? Everything changes when you know who's with you.
Amen.
So what mom couldn't do when it came to peace for Lexi, what dad couldn't do when it came to peace for Lexi, the presence of the Prince of Peace did for Lexi.
That's right.
Man. Man. But have you ever lost sleep because of somebody else? Has somebody else's storm ever kept you up? Yeah. In Matthew and Mark's gospel, there's a familiar synoptic story. There's a familiar synoptic story in those gospels about Jesus sleeping on a boat one day. One day, Jesus and his disciples got into a boat, and Jesus decides to take a power nap. Yeah. He decides to take a power nap. He's out. He's gone. He's asleep. One, two, three. He's gone. Right? And a furious storm pops up. Furious storm pops up. These professional sailors were scared. And these disciples, they run to Jesus, and they wake him up. They're like, Lord, save us. We're about to drown. And Jesus stands to his feet. They wake him up from his sleep. It's their storm, but they wake him up. He stands up. He opens his holy, sleepy eyes, and he starts to rub them, and he speaks to the storm as the wind and waves are splashing over the boat, and he says, peace, be still. And he goes back. Takes a nap. Listen, I thank God for the presence of Jesus, but peace in the storm isn't the absence of the storm.
That's right.
Peace in the storm is the presence of Jesus.
That's right.
Amen. Peace in the storm isn't the absence of the storm. Peace in the storm is the presence of Jesus.
Yes.
So he will bring peace. I thank God for the Prince of Peace. You can lose everything this Christmas, and you can still have peace as long as you have the Prince of Peace.
Amen.
When you know the Prince of Peace, then you know what you have in a storm.
Yeah.
Because what you have is all you need.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. So if I can martialize, modernize, and summarize this message right here, I'm going to share this, and then you can go on with your last-minute Christmas shopping after the service. All chapter 27 is telling us is, for 2 weeks, Paul was in a storm, but he had the presence of God with him. Paul was in the storm, but he had the presence of God with him. Your Bible says that at midnight, on this one particular night, that the ship was being driven across the sea. And the guys were scared. They were hungry. So the crew anchored themselves. They dropped several anchors, and then they let down the lifeboats in the rear. And Paul was like, wait, 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 what's up? You guys can't jump into this raging storm. He said, an angel visited me last night and said that we're going to make it. We're going to be fine. So they cut the anchors, and they listened to Paul. You know, they had a plan. I thought about it when I read this. I was like, Tiff, they had a plan. But sometimes the best time to have a plan is before you're in the storm.
Yeah, that's right.
No, it's a plan, but it was not the right plan. So Paul tells him to wait. Wait. No one will be harmed because God spoke to me last night. God spoke to me last night. He said that everybody will survive. And so when the morning came, this was at midnight now. This was at midnight. So when the morning came, they saw the shore. They saw the shore, and they felt hopeful. And this was their plan. After 2 weeks of being hungry, Paul said, guys, we need to eat. And so he took whatever little rations they had because he realized no one's eating. And so when you're hangry and worried, you know, things look worse. So he takes bread. It's in the text. You got to read the whole chapter, chapter 27. So he takes bread and he starts breaking it and passing it out. And then Paul does the unthinkable. He stands and he gives thanks in the middle of a storm.
Yep.
And I wonder who's thankful for what little you have. Things may not look the way you want it to look, but who's thankful for what you have in the middle of a storm? So they saw the shore. Paul's like, hey, we need to eat. If we're going to make it there, we need to eat. This is the plan. Let's eat. And in the strength they had, they cut the anchors, and their plan was to let the ship drift as close as it can to the shore, and once it runs aground and the ship starts to break it up, they'll jump off ship, and they'll swim for it, and make it the rest of the way. That was the plan. That's what they did.
Yeah.
Your Bible says, it says it like this, they escaped all safe to land. The ship didn't make it because the ship broke apart. It said the ship broke apart. Y'all hear?
Yeah.
The ship broke apart. The ship didn't make it, but the crew did.
Yeah.
And they'd be missing family this year. But thank God for the broken pieces you have in your life. Some of us are missing our virtual our in-person experience, but thank God for the broken pieces that you do have in your life. Whether they're in your home or out of your home, as long as they have broken pieces, they can still make it, and you, your neighbors need to know that this Christmas. In the storm, He'll fulfill every promise He made. In the storm, if we keep swimming, we can make it on broken pieces. And I know some of us are saying, you know, that's the problem, Pastor. I'm not an expert swimmer. But did you hear what I said in the text? Some of them just had boards. And maybe some were doggy paddling with all their strength at the time until a piece came by. But God said, everybody's going to make it. So you may have to, do all you can to make it. But as long as you're making it, even on broken pieces,
right.
And as long as you keep on swimming, say, just keep swimming.
Keep swimming.
As long as you just keep swimming, you're going to be all right. You're going to be all
right.
I want to close with this quote. There's a quote that says, don't tell God how big your storm is. Tell your storm how big your God is.
Yeah.
Don't tell God how big your storm is. A lot of us do that. Oh, this depression. Oh, this divorce. This fear. This anxiety. This whatever it is. This loneliness. This isolation. This disconnectedness, Lord. Don't tell God how big your storm is. Start talking to your storms.
Yep.
Start talking to your storms. And tell your storm how big your God is.
That's right.
Tell your storm how big your God is.
Amen.
Because God is sending broken pieces up in front of you. God is sending broken pieces. And if you receive that, would you put, I receive that in the chat. You don't know. You don't know what you've got because you're looking to stay on the ship. And God said, you're going to make it on broken pieces.
That's right.
But I'll be with you. And so everybody survived. The whole house survived.
Yeah.
All the crew survived. The sailors, the soldiers, the captain of the boat, and Paul, the perfect prisoner, because he was connected to God. They all made it through the storm. Merry Christmas.
Yes.
You're going to make it
yes.
in your storm.
Amen.
Because he's with you. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for the opportunity to share your word. I pray that we realize that although we have broken pieces, we thank you for those broken pieces. We thank you for what you're doing in our families. We thank you for the few that we can connect with. We thank you for those who've made it with meager finances. We thank you for those who've shared their abundance of finances to bless others. We thank you for those that have given up their time, Lord, despite their fears. We thank you for those who've opened up their homes, Lord. We thank you for those who've given all that they had, and they feel like all I have is a plank, but it's enough for me to make it on this broken piece. So, Father, we ask that you would calm the hearts of your people, that you will encourage the hearts of your people, and help us to remember to keep our eyes on you, because with you present, we're going to make it. He is with us. Emmanuel. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Hey, I want to thank you for being with us today. And I want to encourage you to invite someone into the chat next week. We are going to one more location. And we want to remind you to post a picture of your ugly Christmas sweater.
Yep.
Post a picture. We got gingerbread over here. We got the Grinch. And the Grinch is warning us, don't make me turn on my lights. We have Christmas Yoda over here. Matter of fact, would everybody come over here? And can I get a 1, 2, 3 Merry Christmas on the chat real quick? We are live. And I want to get a 1, 2, 3 Merry Christmas to our ReIGNITE family. It's over. The sermon's done. We ask you to be blessed this Christmas. Yes. Everybody. Come on. We on God's dime right here.
Let me get out the way. Ain't got to get in here. You got something other than black on.
Yes. They going to say, it's got on something other than black. Y'all see the ugly Christmas sweaters? We want to remind you also that at 11:30, ReIGNITE Kids Worship will start.
Yep.
It will air. And she's got a Grinch on?
Yeah.
Oh, and you made her turn her Grinch on. We want to remind you that 11:30, the Kids ReIGNITE Worship Experience starts, and so stay tuned for that. We want to thank you, and on the count of three, we want to say Merry Christmas, and then we want to say, go Jesus, it's your birthday. All right? 1, 2, 3.
Merry Christmas! Go Jesus, it's your birthday!
Yay! God bless you guys. Y'all know the ways to give. ReIGNITE Church.org. The giving tab is right there. God bless you.
God bless.